Remember, we're doing the minor prophets chronologically, so there will be a little bit of a rearrange from the way they appear in the Old Testament. But as we saw, Amos, God is rebuking, firstly, the nations around Israel and Judah, and then, secondly, Judah and Israel themselves. And today, here in chapter 3, he continues that here in the first six verses. God said, "Hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family, which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all your iniquities. Can two walk together except they be agreed? Will a lion roar in the forest when he hath no prey? Will the young lion cry out of his den if he have taken nothing? Can a bird fall in a snare upon the earth where no gin is for him? Shall one take up a snare from the earth and have taken nothing at all? Shall a trumpet be blown in the city and the people not be afraid? Shall there be evil in a city and the Lord hath not done it?" So can two walk together? Let's pray. Lord, use your word now to teach us, and we pray you guide us in your truth, and Lord, it'd be a blessing to all of us and a blessing to you at this time as we hear through Amos. Lord, we want to glorify you, and we want to be listening and learning and responding. So we commit all that to you tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. So notice who God is rebuking now. In verse 1, he says, the whole family. So he's speaking now to Israel as a group. Remember that the kingdom is divided into the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. And the northern kingdom referred to as Judah, southern kingdom Israel. But he's talking about all of Israel now. And we know that because he says there in verse 2, you only have I known. What God is saying is of all the people on the earth, God had only chosen one group of people to be his chosen people up to this point, of course, and that is Israel. So God chose them to have a special relationship with him. And he referred to them as his children. If you go to Deuteronomy 7, we'll see this. But that was God's plan, that they would be his children, that they would be a testimony to the world of what happens when a nation has our Creator as their God, and when they're obeying his commandments. But that's not what happened. They instead became a testimony of what happens when they disobey their Creator. But notice Deuteronomy 7, verse 6, "For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth." What is saying? Here he's speaking through Moses just before they go into the promised land. And he says, I chose you to be a special people to myself. And he says, above all people upon the face of the earth. So it's no wonder when Jesus came on the scene that they had so much Jewish pride, if you want to call it that. Because God made statements like this and said, you are my people. You are my special people. And I specially chose you. And I rescued you from Egypt. The problem was, he told them all along, I want you now to be a testimony of me to the nations around you and show them what happens when people follow God, how different they'll be. God ultimately wanted that for them, that they be that testimony. But the opposite is what happened. Now, the good news for you and I is everything changed at Calvary. The Jews are still God's chosen people, no question. But now during the church age, we get to have a special relationship with God through salvation in Jesus Christ. So go to Romans 8 and we'll see this. That doesn't mean we supplant the Jews. And don't ever believe that. There's actually a name for that. These days, it's called covenant theology, and there are churches teaching it, that basically all the promises made to Israel now God's done with Israel, they're gone, and now all those promises are to the church. The problem is many of those promises that were made in the Old Testament were unconditional. And God had repeated them over and over again and said, I will do this, and he will. He just hasn't done it yet. But we now get to be grafted in. We're the wild ones, if you will. And the wild olives. Notice Romans 8:16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. We know that there are other verses that teach that we are adopted into God's family. We become his children. He is our Father. Wednesday night, when we look in John chapter 8, we're going to see when Jesus said to the Jews, you are your father the devil. It didn't go over too well. But that's true of all unsaved people. God is not their father. He's their God and their creator, but he's not their father until they're his children. And we're not his children until we're adopted into God's family. And that, of course, happens miraculously when we trust Christ as Savior. God makes us one of his. So what God is saying, go back to our passage, he says, you're my special children. I've chosen you. I've pulled you out of Egypt. I gave you the land that I promised you. I've watched over you. I've protected you. Look at verse 2 of Amos 3 at the end of the verse. Therefore, so because I specially chose you of all the families of the earth, therefore I will punish you for all your iniquities. God doesn't chastise the unsaved. Understand that. Now they will be punished for their sins in hell. But he doesn't chastise them for sinning here on earth. Because they're not his children. Just like we don't chastise other people's children. God does not chastise the devil's children. He chastises his own. So what he's saying is, because I chose you, because you are my special people, because you are my nation that I created from nothing through Abraham, you are my special family, my children, therefore, I'll punish you. I will chastise you, just as all loving fathers should chastise their children. So Proverbs 3, turn there if you would. Written by Solomon, one of the greatest kings of Israel that ever lived, a Jewish king. Look what he says, Proverbs 3:11. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. Again, that's why God doesn't chastise the unsaved. They're not his children. We get to the New Testament, Hebrews 12, and he says it to you and I. He says, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. And so he says to Israel, I specially chose you. You are my special people, my family. And therefore, I have no choice but to chastise you. Because you were meant to be a testimony, and instead, you have been running my name through the mud. Through your behavior. And then that brings us to verse 3 of our passage, a very well-known verse, which people tend to apply it to life all the time. But he says, can two walk together except they be agreed? And then he asks a bunch of questions there in verses 4, 5, and 6. They're rhetorical questions, of course. And the obvious answer to every one of those questions is no. But he throws them in there to say, the answer to verse 3 is no. Two people cannot walk together if they're not agreed. But God is specifically talking about himself and his children. But he's also referring way back to the Garden of Eden. Let's go to Genesis 3 and see this. There was a time before the fall when God literally walked with man. Think about that. Genesis chapter 3, look at verse 8. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. This is right after their fall. Up to this point, God would come down and walk and talk with Adam. And literally, they would have conversations together. They walked together. That was all lost right here at this point. When they chose to hide themselves from God, rather than go out and meet and greet and spend time with God, now because of sin, now because of their knowledge of good and evil, they hid. Move forward to the New Testament. What does God want from us? Go to Galatians chapter 5. He wants us to walk with him. Now, we can't physically walk with him in the church age. But don't forget, we are his temple. And he lives in us. And what does he command us here in Galatians 5:16? This I say then, walk in the Spirit. And ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So though we cannot walk with God physically until we get to heaven, we can walk in the Spirit. And the Spirit is God. We can yield to him. We can talk to him. We can listen to him. When he convicts us, when he teaches us, when he guides us, which is why he's here. We can walk in him. And the Bible says in 1 John 2:6, he that saith he abideth in him, ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. We're here to walk like Jesus and to walk in the Spirit. Adam and Eve walked with God and talked with God until the fall. God says to Israel, can two walk together? He specifically says, can I walk with you? Can we walk and talk together when we're in disagreement? When I'm holy and righteous and you are disobeying my commandments? And again, he has the rhetorical questions to teach us that nothing. The answer is no. So he says, except they be agreed. And that was the problem, wasn't it? Remember back in chapter 2 of Amos, go back there, verse 4, which we looked at week before last and last week. Thus saith the Lord, for three transgressions of Jacob and for four, I will not turn away the punishment thereof, because they have despised the law of the Lord and have not kept his commandments, and their lies caused them to err after the which their fathers have walked. And then last week we looked at verse 12 of chapter 2. But you gave the Nazarites wine to drink and commanded the prophets, saying, prophesy not. It was Israel that made the decision to stop agreeing with God. God didn't say, I'm now in disagreement with you. Israel said, we are now in disagreement with God. We are the ones who always make that choice. Psalm 66:18, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. It always starts with us deciding to sin, us deciding to disobey, and then God has to back away. And we're not walking with him. Isaiah 59, we'll turn there, verses 1 and 2. Very important truth. But what God ultimately is saying to Israel is, until we're in agreement again, we can't walk together. And he says the same to Christians. When they're living in sin, when they're living in disobedience, he says, until we are in agreement, we can't walk together. Until we repent of our sin, until we get right with God, our walk with God is affected. Isaiah 59, look at verse 1. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. The It doesn't say cannot, it says will not. Big difference, isn't it? He will not. God has to back away when we're in disagreement. And that's why he tells us, go to 2 Corinthians 6, that we are to be separate from sin so that we can walk with him. He's trying to tell that to Israel. Of course, they didn't listen. But through Amos, he's saying, can we continue to walk together? Me as your father, you as my children, you as my special people that I chose centuries ago. Can we keep walking together when we're in complete disagreement about right and wrong? No. The Bible says in Habakkuk chapter 1, thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil. God hates sin. That's never been different. It's always been true. And if you want to know how much, look at Calvary. That's how much he hates sin. 2 Corinthians 6:14, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness, and what communion hath light with darkness? It's exactly what God is saying. Righteousness and unrighteousness can't have communion together. God is righteous. God is holy. He says, if you're going to walk in unrighteousness and sin and be disobedient to my commandments, we can't walk together. He said it to Israel, and I believe he says it to us, that he wants us to walk with him. You know, we sing that hymn. I walk with him and I talk with him. Come to the garden alone. God wants that. He wants us to think about why he created us. It wasn't just an experiment. Oh, I think I'll just make man and see what happens. No, he created us for fellowship. And we see that in the garden prior to the fall. He created us to have someone to fellowship with. And that was lost at the fall, but when Jesus died on that cross and rose again, and that veil was rent in twain from top to bottom, you and I can now approach the throne of the Creator of the universe. It's amazing, isn't it? Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace. We can come boldly, not because of who we are, but because of Jesus, his blood, his righteousness that's been applied to our account. But if we try to approach the throne, which we're allowed to do, we have access to, with sin in our life that's not been dealt with, that sweet fellowship that God wants us to have is hindered. Until we're agreed, we can't walk together. A lot of applications there, but specifically a very good one for you and me, that God wants us to walk with him and talk with him, spend time with him. But he wants us to do it with us in agreement with each other. That sin is sin, and he hates sin. And he wants us to come to him having dealt with sin, which is why the Bible says, we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Praise the Lord. So can two walk together except they be agreed? The answer is no. So we need to agree with God that sin is sin, and that we are doing our best to stay away from it so that we can walk and talk with him as our best friend. Abba Father. Amen? Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful truth. I pray that it will sink into our hearts.